Hey guys, and welcome to Collider Movie Talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Natasha Martinez, and this is the daily show where we give you all the latest news in the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Joining us today is John Campea.
Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to the best damn movie-related show on the planet Earth, coming to you from right here at the Collider Video Studios here in Burbank, California, and we are so glad you decided to make us part of your day.
Also joining us, Jon Schnepp.
What's up, everybody? Can't wait to talk about all this crazy business.
Crazy. Also joining us is Jeremy Jahns.
I'd like to give a special shout out to Jon Schnepp's Logan's Run shirt. That's just fantastic right there. Brings me right back to my childhood, and that's what we try to do for you guys every day.
And rounding off our panel, Kristian Harloff.
Why do I see t-shirts being started? Crazy business. Schnepp's face.
All right, there's a whole bunch of stuff to cover today, so Natasha, get us started.
Over the past few months, original Deadpool writers Rhett, Reese, and Paul Wernick have been hard at work on the sequel, and now, thanks to a new exclusive from Collider.com, we have word of a new writer also pitching in a hand, Drew Goddard. According to the report, Ryan Reynolds is working with Goddard, with Reese and Wernick still extremely involved in the script, with Goddard added as a consultant. The move seems to show that everyone involved is hoping to get the script just right, however, a release date has still not officially been announced. John, what do you think about Drew Goddard being added as a consultant and writer for Deadpool 2?
I love it, actually, which is really good that we got some clarification, because the first word that came out was that just Ryan Reynolds and Drew Goddard were going to be writing, doing the rewrite. And it's like, where's Rhett and Paul? Where's Rhett and Paul, the guys who wrote the first one? And as it turns out, and then Ryan Reynolds tweeted out last night just a clarification saying, hey, Rhett and Paul are also involved in this completely. They are completely key, which is great because those guys are wonderful. So now you get this brain trust of Ryan Reynolds, Rhett and Paul, and now you add to that the guy who created the Daredevil TV show, was supposed to be the showrunner for season one. He also directed Cabin in the Woods, didn't he not?
He wrote and directed.
Wrote and directed that with Joss Whedon as well. And then he was tapped to do the next Spider-Man movie before the deal between Spider-Man and between Sony and Marvel took place.
Sinister Six, right?
He was going to do the Sinister Six one. So this is a guy who has been kind of sitting there, and a lot of fans are waiting, when is this guy going to get more majorly involved in a project like this? So when you get the brain trust of Ryan, Rhett, and Paul, and you add Goddard to come in and do the next draft of the script, that can only be good things. It is never a mistake to add talent. This guy's a world-class talent. I cannot wait for this, so I think this is terrific news. Schnepp, what about you?
Yeah, I think it's great, too. And I mean, sometimes when you hear these kinds of things, like somebody came in to rewrite someone else's script, a lot of the times it's like everyone's sitting in a room like throwing ideas at the wall. It could be those two original writers and Ryan Reynolds and Drew all sitting in the room talking about it. Other ways they do it is like, hey, you did your first pass. We're going to take a pass on it, you know, try to add to it plus the script, and then they come back in. So, I mean, I don't see it as adversarial. I would probably see, especially the way Reynolds is talking about it, it's like they're still the heartbeat of it. They're like, they came up with a storyline, they wrote the script, now we're just going to plus scenes and have their input. That's my guess.
What do you think, Jeremy?
Yeah, there's a big part of me that always likes to be a creature of habit. You know, it's like, how about we have everything that lined up in the first movie and not change a thing? But that's just not realistic. I mean, 9 out of 10 sequels that I like had something new added to it, something different, a new fresh mind in there. And given his credentials, I mean, he's a great addition to Deadpool 2 to make Deadpool 2 on par, if not, you know, I mean, because everyone who makes a sequel wants to surpass the first one, you know what I mean? So, I mean, it looks like they're on the road to doing it, but time will tell, time will validate, but right now I'm still smiling about Deadpool 2 because of this.
If you go to past resume, like we've just been talking about, whether it's Cabin in the Woods or, you know, the Daredevil, the tone seems to fit. And it seems like the humor that was in Cabin in the Woods and also the tone in general, putting that inside of Deadpool, obviously he knows from talking to Ryan Reynolds, I'm sure he understands the property, and then working with the original screenwriters. I think it seems like a good marriage. I hope that it would be. And the fact that Ryan Reynolds came out to say, no, everybody's still involved. Everyone's playing nice. Mm-hmm. I believe it. I think that it's going to work out for the best.
Yeah, nobody's replacing anybody. This is in addition to bring in a new fresh set of eyes, which is really good because look, the first Deadpool was so fantastic. I mean, it was just, I can't even express how much I love that film. But if you're not careful with a movie like Deadpool and doing a sequel, you could fall into a trap of just doing the same thing without, because when you have big success, it's like, what do you change? It's harder to see the things to change mm-hmm. when you're successful. It's a lot easier when you're failing at something, you can pick out the weak areas. So bringing in a new fresh set of eyes, to bring a new fresh perspective, to say, let's not just do everything we did before, let's sharpen it up. I think this is really smart on the part of Ryan, Rhett, and Paul to bring in another set of eyes. I think Drew's a great guy to do it. And again, I know I go on this all the time, but Deadpool is just such a great example, along with Logan, and all of us can't wait for you guys to see Logan because you are going to love it. Another great example of why, no, not everything should just go back to Marvel, because some things are doing quite well outside of Marvel, and it gives us new and different flavors. All right, what's next?
20th Century Fox has released an extended prologue for Alien Covenant that teases Ridley Scott's Prometheus follow-up. The prologue is not actually part of the film, but is a short film directed by Scott's son, Luke Scott, called Prologue Last Supper. It shows the crew of the Covenant having a last supper before entering cryosleep. The film stars Katherine Watterson, Billy Crudup, Danny McBride, and James Franco. It opens on May 19th. Jeremy, thoughts on the new Alien and Covenant prologue?
I thought it was fine. I feel like if I lived in a world where I never saw this, I feel like Alien Covenant would still be exactly what it is. You know, it's a neat little look into the crew. You start getting a feel of the crew. You're sitting around. You see a lot of similarities to them eating dinner in Alien. And this one thing I was like, I just wanted more blood. I told Kristian that. I was like, man, I just wanted more blood and carnage and slaughter. But as an introduction to the crew, I think it was fine. Was it necessary? No. But it's one of those extras where it's like, yeah, but you have it. You know, so since you have it, enjoy it, tonally speaking, I am looking forward to Alien Covenant. It put it on the forefront of my mind because, I mean, you get lost in like Kong Skull Island's coming out soon and still gushing about Logan. Alien Covenant is kind of pushed off to the back, so to speak. So something like this kind of brings it to the forefront, like, hey dude, that's coming out soon. I start getting excited about it. So in that, gotta like it.
I watched this prelude last night, mm-hmm. but then we're in here this morning watching it, and as it starts to play, you know, Jeremy's going, oh, one of these guys is going to die.
Yeah,
one of these guys is going to die. What's going to happen? Someone's going to die. And then when the moment that one girl starts going, oh, he's like, here it comes. Here it comes. And it's like, you know what this really reminded me of a lot? Remember Ridley Scott's The Martian did this exact same thing where they put out, like a few months before the movie came out, they put out the thing where it was the whole crew of their ship mm-hmm. heading to Mars. Mm-hmm. Now, when The Martian begins, they're already on Mars. But it's the crew heading to Mars doing their video diaries that they're sending back. It had all the cast mm-hmm. in it. It's a nice, simple little thing to do. They probably shot this while they had all the cast together. Let's do this quick thing. We're going to spend half a day, shoot this one little thing that we're going to use as a marketing tool. Because it does exactly what you say. It brings it to the forefront, reminds us of this movie coming. Because we've got three stacked weeks coming between Logan, and then the following week, Kong, and then the following week, Beauty and the Beast. And so if you want to keep Alien in everybody's mind, this is a good way to do it. I really liked it.
I love it. And it's not because when you look at it, if you look at it, this was something from the movie and like, that's okay. We're going to see what's going to happen. It's kind of a setup for the overall film. And it didn't see much if it was a scene from the movie. But this was, like you said, a marketing tool. This is to let me know that it's very similar to the tone of the original Alien. It felt like an Alien movie setup. I felt like I was in that world. But it was to say, these are the people you're going to be dealing with. Say goodbye to James Franco because he's probably going to die. Right. That's the way that they set that up in that particular scene.
I'm not feeling good.
Okay,
Alien
Captain.
And stomach bubble.
Right. And then it's you know, cue your Bill Paxton with Danny McBride. And it's like, you the way that they gave you kind of the cast of characters who already you know a little bit about them. If you choose to watch this, when you go into the movie going, oh, well, that's who that person is. And like Jeremy says, it doesn't take away from the movie. It doesn't like add anything or really like hurt your experience if you miss it. But the fact that you see it, I think it is a very cool and different way to market the film. I really like the marketing of it.
And it reminds us that all spaceship pilots have to wear cowboy hats.
Right. And never I think forget Coffee McGee is going to die by the hands of that new android, David, because that was like a little like a precursor setup where you're like, you know, she's choking and you're getting that whole John Hurt, you know, alien explosion feeling. But instead, I got your back. And I feel like that's going to come back in the movie. I love this because it is not a spoiler in any way.
No,
this is not part of the movie. It's directed by his son, who also did a really great short that's very much Blade Runner.
He's
a good director, I think, you know. And this felt, like you said, it felt like we were in the Alien universe, But my favorite thing about it is definitely seeing the crew before the movie starts. So, you know, if they did more trailers like this, like gave you like a 5 minute or even a month before the movie starts, I would be 100% in, even more so than seeing a trailer, you know?
You know, I'm now thinking about how absurd I sounded when I'm like, oh, someone's going to bite it. Someone's going to bite it. It's like, yeah, genius. Someone's going to bite it in the movie before the movie even starts in the promo material, idiot. So, yeah, I didn't even think about that. I still wanted someone to bite it, though.
All right, guys, well, it is Thursday, which means it's time for us to talk about what is opening this week. A bunch of new films opening in theaters. So, Natasha, what is opening in theaters this week?
Collide, which obviously was named after our YouTube channel, is opening this week. To pay for his girlfriend's medical emergency while abroad, a man played by Nicholas Hoult hatches a scheme to pull off a drug heist for an eccentric gangster played by Anthony Hopkins. Get Out is also coming out this week. Now that Chris, played by Daniel Kaluuya, and his girlfriend Rose, played by Allison Williams, have reached the meet the parents milestone of dating, she invites him for a weekend getaway upstate with Missy and Dean. At first, Chris reads the family's overly accommodating behavior as nervous attempts to deal with their daughter's interracial relationship, but as the weekend progresses, a series of increasingly disturbing discoveries led him to a truth that he never could have imagined.
Can we get a little wide shot for a second? You can't see it, unfortunately. We got the poster of Collide over here, and the tagline on the poster is, "How far would you go for the one you love?" Apparently not far enough to actually market the film.
Yeah.
Because, like, I remember when we were putting these things, this list together about the films, I was like, Collide. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
Like, this one, they played hide and seek with this movie. Like, nobody had any idea this movie. And when you've got a movie with this cast, including Anthony Hopkins, and you are like hiding it desperately, that ain't a good sign. I have not seen the film. I'm pretty positive they haven't had any critic screenings for it. I could be wrong about that. I'm off the top of my head. Now, Get Out, on the other hand. Directorial debut by Jordan Peele. Written also by Jordan Peele. This is fresh, it's creative, it's original, with little touches of homages to some classic horror and thriller movies of the past thrown in as well. The performances by, who is it, Williams and Kaluuya, were amazing. The performances of the supporting cast as well.
Riley Whitford.
Oh my God, like, you know, we're sitting in the same scene right now. Yeah. That they make it creepy and fun. And look, and I do have one overriding criticism of the movie that doesn't take away from my enjoyment, but unfortunately I can't mention the criticism because it would be, by definition, a spoiler, so you can't do that. But I would recommend going out and checking out Get Out this week. What about you, Jeremy?
Yeah, Get Out's the one that I've seen everyone gush about because it's, you know, Jordan Peele's directorial debut, and I love directorial debuts. You know, it's like when Joel Edgerton directed The Gift.
Right.
You know, you're like, I want to see what this dude does. And then if it lands, it sticks, and it's good, then you're like, I want him to direct more. I don't want to just see him in front of the camera. I want to see him behind the camera, you know? So that's what we were talking about. I think it was yesterday when we were like, give them something to, you know, whet their appetite on, and then see what they do with a bigger property. But I've heard that Get Out is actually really good. Looking forward to that. Missed the critic screening. Missed the screening for Collide also, because I don't think there was one.
No.
And it feels like, I feel like this looks like a movie that was supposed to come out 5 years ago that everyone signed on to before they got as big as they were. Kind of like House at the End of the Street, I think it was, with...
Like, before Anthony Hopkins got big.
That's how long ago they shot this movie. Back when
with
he did
Amber
Free
Heard
Jack.
It was
the Katniss, who did, I can't think of her
name.
Jennifer Lawrence. She was in that, was it called House at the End of the Street? It was that she was contracted to do. Yeah, it was the hashtag hates. She was contracted to do it before she got big. So she's like, oh, now I'm me, but I still have to do that thing. I feel like that's what that is. It has the same vibe.
I think Riley was telling me that this movie has actually been sitting on a shelf for a long time.
I don't doubt it at all. You heard it from here first. You got validation from Riley. I don't have a 5-year-old, so I'm not seeing Rock Dog. So Get Out is the one that I'm looking forward to for sure.
Snap.
Yeah, when I said Rock Dog, is that Hong Kong Phooey?
It's not that bad.
It's not? You like it?
That's all right.
Well, I got a chance to see. I did see Collide.
But I don't think it's opening this week,
it's
is
pretty
it?
Good.
It is.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. It's pretty, it's really
you
good.
You saw Collide.
No, I'm just kidding.
No, no one saw Collide.
I've never even heard of this.
I don't even think Nicholas Hoult has seen Collide.
I mean, I haven't heard of a lot of these films that just show up on VOD. You're like, Henry Cavill and Bruce Willis are in some Explodo spy mission film.
Yeah, that one, that's real, by the way.
Save My Daughter Yesterday or whatever the hell that's called. That's real. And that just shows up. And you're like,
because they have to release it.
This somehow made it into the theater, but none of us even heard of it. It's amazing.
Well, look, you've got the star of Rogue One, so you're hoping, hoping that someone will go and see it. The response of, will there be any screenings for this? No screenings for this one. Sorry about that. It's like, I'm sure you are. there are no screenings for this movie, nor will there be any viewings of this movie from anyone paying money. It is just, I guarantee it's going to be stink. And the fact that it's coming out in February is an accomplishment. It should have came out in the beginning of January or on Blu-ray. But maybe I'm wrong, and maybe it's a Best Picture winner. Let's see. But Rock Dog is something that if you have kids, you should see. It's better than it should have been. Is it a good movie? Not necessarily, but it's entertaining. And Get Out is the one to absolutely see. People keep talking about original movies. You got one with Split this year, and now you're going to get one with Get Out. Go and support these movies. When they're good, that's when we'll tell you to go and see them, and go and see this one. You should be supporting it. It is original. It is a good directorial debut. And it's it does creep you well.
All right, let me throw this out there. Okay. I'm going to do an over-under with you guys.
Ooh.
Over under for the opening weekend box office of Collide. I'm going to set the over under at $2.1 million. $2.1 million. Snap is going to make over or under $2.1 million.
Under.
Under 2.1. Jeremy.
That's an abysmally low number. I'm going to say over, but I really hope it makes under.
Over, but barely. I'm going to say maybe like 4 mil.
I'm going to take the under on 2 points. I'm going to take the under.
With those stars and the fact that it's probably got some marketing, and because someone's really like, what the hell is this?
I haven't seen any of it.
Yeah.
Honestly, have you seen any trailers or marketing for it?
Yeah, right there.
Yeah, I'm saying this is the first time I've seen it right here on our show.
We are the biggest piece of marketing for Collide.
We're the reason it's going to make $1.8 million.
Yeah. All right, guys, we've reached that part of the show now for buy or sell. Here's how this works. In front of her, Natasha's got a few other items in the world of movie news. She's going to run them down. And those of us at the table are simply going to say whether we buy it or sell it. So, Natasha, what do we got?
According to an exclusive report from Collider.com, Joe Carnahan is writing the new X-Force movie for 20th Century Fox. Fox is on a hot streak with their R-rated superhero movies, so Carnahan's tone seems to be a natural fit for the grittier spin on the X-Men Task Force. As of now, Carnahan is only writing the script for X-Force and is not currently attached to direct, with a release date yet to be determined. Schnepp, buy or sell Joe Carnahan writing an X-Force movie?
Man, I am buying this 100%. Narc with mutants. I can't wait to see Joe Carnahan unleashed with superheroes. I mean, you know what I mean? It's Smoking Aces. He's done a lot of different films that are a lot of fun. And The Gray is definitely fun in a different way. I think he's an incredibly talented director. He's an incredibly talented writer. Can't wait to see what he did with Uncharted. So I think this makes supernatural sense for him to go right into the mutant world. So great. I can't buy it enough.
Jeremy.
I'm buying it, but my biggest form of curiosity comes from what mutants are going to be in X-Force that are in the comic books, what are not going to be in the X-Force movie that might be in the comic books. Like, given the timelines that the X-Men movies have, where are they? Where are they going? Who's going to be in it? Are there going to be different actors playing certain characters? I don't know, but it's fascinating. I feel like that's an exclusively X-Men and Fox thing where you can actually have that question in your head. Because usually it's like, oh, okay, we're springboarding this property. Someone's doing an Avengers spinoff something. You know who is going to play Tony Stark. You know who's going to play Steve Rogers. You know. But with X-Men, we're like, I don't know, they might recast everyone. They might recast half the people. I don't know what they're going to do. But for all the reasons you said, I'm excited for it. And give us another spinoff timeline in the X-Men universe.
Yeah, I think that's what I'm excited about also, is another spinoff. But to see what Carnahan can do, and see, he's getting his name out there a lot recently, whether it's Bad Boys and The Raid. And
Uncharted.
I'd like to see that he's coming back and doing more, because he's such a talented director. And I like that. What I like about Carnahan's got an edge. And as we've seen with Logan now and Deadpool, put a little edge on these things. And I think that's the guy you get. See what he's going to do. I think this makes sense. I like the choice.
All right, what's next?
After taking a bit of a break following the release of Unbroken, Angelina Jolie is lining up a series of new projects. Per The Hollywood Reporter, Jolie has acting offers that include a return for Maleficent 2 and a pair of large-scale projects at Universal, Catherine the Great and Potemkin, The Imperial Love Affair, and a World War II spy drama called The Spy Who Loved. As for directorial efforts, THR adds that Jolie is preparing an adaptation of Alessandro Barrico's novel Without Blood. Christian, buy or sell Angelina Jolie doing Maleficent 2?
Oh, I couldn't sell it. I would sell that more than I could sell anything. I out of all of them, not including the sequel to Alice in Wonderland 2, I find it to be the worst Disney adaptation so far, because of what they did to the mythology of it. I thought it was just a way to serve Angelina Jolie's star instead of actually paying homage to what the character really was all about. I liked the idea of telling me why Maleficent was bad. I liked that. I liked adding it, because that's very similar to what they did with Cinderella and even what they did, you know, with Jungle Book and adding some stuff to the original. But they just flipped it completely on its head. It's like, and now she's a good guy because Angelina Jolie doesn't want to be a bad
Christian,
guy.
Spoilers, man.
Please.
Spoilers.
You're lucky I did that.
I can't believe you ruined the movie. I still haven't seen Maleficent.
Right. So there's no reason for this to be a sequel. This is where you start to get into dangerous territory, where it's like it did very well. It actually helped you do Cinderella and the other movies too. We don't need Maleficent 2. We just don't need it. Even if it was good, we wouldn't need it to where it can continue. So I would say get away from that. Her other stuff, I like what she's doing. I think she's a talented filmmaker. I didn't love Unbroken, but I think that there's other.
It was quite good though. It was good.
I thought it looked really good. I thought that I thought that it was built up a little bit more than I think she could. I don't know. I want to see her do something else.
Didn't she direct By the Sea?
Yeah, and I didn't like that.
I really like that.
So I haven't liked what she's done so far. I don't think she's a bad director. I think she's actually a good director. I just haven't liked the movie she's done so far, but I think that she definitely, I'm interested in seeing more what she's going to do. But no, Maleficent 2, no thank you.
I want to see Angelina Jolie direct a movie with Brad Pitt and Jennifer Aniston starring.
Oh.
I think that would be. Come on, don't pretend you wouldn't be fascinated to see that movie.
It's called Salt 2, Under the Skin.
Oh, that's salty. Don't get salty.
Now, here's the funny thing about Maleficent. Angelina Jolie was great. Angelina Jolie was great in Maleficent. I mean, the performance she gives was bonkers. That movie sucked. And I mean, but it was a bad film. I mean, Disney's a great studio. They crank out some wonderful stuff. And they also gave us Alice in Wonderland and Alice in Wonderland 2 and Maleficent. And the best thing that Maleficent did is it made us appreciate just how good the Cinderella movie was that came after it. And I was actually nervous for that Cinderella movie, but this like, oh, okay, you know, put it in the hands of Kenneth Branagh and everything will be just fine. No, you dear heavens, don't go back and do Maleficent 2. I understand it made some money at the box office, but it was a bad decision the way the direction they took that movie in. And it's a direction you can't come back from. So now you're just going to perpetuate and build upon the mistakes you made, and it's just going to make the second one even worse. She's an outstanding world-class actress. Put her in anything else. She's showing she's got some chops as a director. Give her something else. Please, Angelina, do not waste your time on a Maleficent 2.
The reason that she probably wouldn't think it's wasting time, to be fair, the movie made an insane amount of money.
Oh, yeah, it made money. I get it.
So I could see why they're doing it. I just don't think we need it.
Like, but it's not like Disney is hurting for properties that's going to make them money if they put out another one.
Well, they made Planes 3. So, I mean, come on. They're not going to. They follow
the money.
That
was straight to video.
Saying,
but would you buy or sell Angelina doing Maleficent 2?
I sell it because I agree. I don't think there has to be a Maleficent 2. We saw Maleficent 1. I agree with Christian. I thought the look of it was beautiful. She was great in the role, but the story just kind of like betrayed the character to make her a good guy. You know, the best bad guys is when you actually can sympathize with their point of view.
Yeah.
So we should have been able to sympathize with Maleficent and not have her be a goody two-shoes at the end. So anyway, I don't want to see Maleficent 2. I want to see her in Bride of Frankenstein. So that's the other Universal property that I think she would be great in.
You know, she's been trying to get going for years, and this was also part of the Sony email hacks, but we know this for a fact. She was trying to do a Cleopatra.
Oh, yeah. That would have been fantastic.
Angelina
with
Jolie
Fincher.
I believe Fincher was
going to direct it.
Can you imagine how good that could have been?
Would've
anyway,
been
Jeremy, what do you think about all this?
Yeah, I feel this is it's a big gamble because their live action movies after Maleficent kind of like found their track, they found their ground, they were actually movies that were in line with why people loved the animations. And so Maleficent 2, kind of, I feel like that's going to take it back to that shady kind of critically divisive and fan divisive world of, well, some like it, some don't. I do agree that she was great as Maleficent. So here, they can take a page out of the Fox playbook, just remake Maleficent. Don't even call it Maleficent 2. Call it like Maleficent Rebirth or something like that. And just remake the entire movie where she is She's a good person who falls bad, and now she's just evil. Make the movie we want, and you can buy it there. That being said, I will probably sell it because it's too much backtracking when they have good momentum in where they're going with their live action film.
Now, I have two questions for Wendy Lee. Question number one, what do you think about this whole possibility of her going back to do Maleficent 2? That's question one. Go ahead and take that.
Possibility should be at -0, -200. I don't know. She shouldn't do it. The movie was terrible, and I had such high hopes for it because when I first saw the photos of what Maleficent looked like, wow, she looked amazing. And, you know, I heard, like, the production for this long cape she had, they had to piece together different leathers and whatever. And I was like, you can't even make Angelina look bad as a villain. Like, she looks beautiful and haunting. And then I watched the movie. It's like you take one of Disney's best villains and you make her misunderstood. And then what happened? I wasn't afraid of her. No, she's just misunderstood. She was scorned by a man. Come on now. There is no need for a second one. The story ended. It was crap. Let's just move on. Angelina, you're talented. You're beautiful. Go do something else.
Now, the question number two I have is, Wendy, are you allergic to cats?
Not Perry's cat. Is that why?
Oh, because yeah. Because
I woke up because with
Perry brought in her
allergy.
Cat today. This has been funny to me. Perry brought in her cat today, and all day I've seen Wendy like sniffling and then halfway through the show running out and grabbing boxes of Kleenexes. I thought it was like, there it is. Oh, she can't even reach it.
Wendy's
there
just it is. Crying over Maleficent, too.
She's just That's crying why. Over Maleficent.
That's why she has the tissue.
Don't worry, Wendy. It's not going to happen.
All right. What's next?
Okay, a new trailer for The Discovery starring Robert Redford, Jason Segel, and Rooney Mara has been released. The movie, which had its world premiere at the Sundance Film Festival last month, is the latest film from director Charlie McDowell and stars Robert Redford as a scientist who discovers a new plane of existence beyond our world, essentially throwing the entire population of Earth into crisis. Jason Segel plays Redford's son, and Rooney Mara plays the woman he meets after returning to his hometown. It hits Netflix on March 31st, 2017. John Byer saw the new trailer for The Discovery.
This is really interesting because I remember we did a story on this when it was first announced it was going into production probably about a year ago. But the conundrum that this story sets up is fascinating. If a scientist scientifically proves an afterlife or what they're calling a different plane of existence after this life, this movie, then you know the trailer's showing that the suicide rate in the world like goes up by a million times, like 4 million people committed suicide just after hearing this kind of stuff. And then the question posed in the trailer, was it the right thing to do to reveal this truth? And that's a good question. Is it wrong to reveal truth? If he finds out something and it's truth and it's a part that is something, a truth that affects everybody, should you not reveal that or should truth be out there? It's a great thing. That being said, I didn't love the trailer. I love the synopsis of the movie that the trailer conveys, and I'm fascinated to watch this. Once again, another thing that's going on to Netflix. So I'm very, very curious about it. But I just still think that as a trailer, it could have been constructed in such a way that just the premise of the movie wasn't the only thing selling me on the movie. I wish the trailer itself could have done a little bit better of a job with that on its own. So just the trailer? I'm buying the movie, but I'm going to sell the trailer. Christian, what do you think?
I'm going to buy the trailer. I think that it for those reasons, actually, I think because I had no idea what the hell this movie was about or what it was, but I got a clear-cut vision of what the movie is all about and what the dilemma I should be feeling from the trailer. I think it set up the story pretty well. It set up the dilemmas of the characters involved. It set up kind of I already know what I'm getting into, and it also just goes into this conversation that we were having yesterday about Netflix. This is just a different. We're starting to see a different change in the guard of certain. I mean, no, this isn't a big, huge Scorsese movie or big Scorsese movie, but this is a movie that has some really serious talent that is going to be debuting on Netflix, and I think that this is going to start to be a wave of where independent movies right now. It is hard for filmmakers to get independent movies made. It's hard for them to put them out in theaters because a lot of people don't go and see them. There's not a lot of studios putting money. Netflix is starting to change that because if you're a filmmaker and you could do a movie with Robert Redford, Seagal, Rooney, and you know that a lot of people are going to see it now because it's going to be on Netflix, it's a different way to do movies. It really is changing, and Amazon's doing the same thing, and all these. So this is very. We should all be encouraged that this type of movie is hitting Netflix.
Jeremy.
Yeah, that was the first thing I thought when Natasha was breaking it down over here, how it premiered at, what was it, Sundance?
Yeah.
It premieres at Sundance. It used to be, all right, now we need a studio to grab onto it so we can get a theatrical release. Not anymore. Now it can just come out on Netflix. It's just a different paradigm that we're shifting into. As for the trailer, buying the trailer, because it is so fascinating to me for everything that you listed, where it's this moral dilemma. It's the end of Watchmen, where it's like, okay, if this truth gets out there, would it be worse for mankind? That's just, I mean, that locked me in. I think when we were watching the trailer, I said something like, that is dark. Yeah. I like it. Yeah. And then Christian's like, you morbid bastard.
I said, what a creep.
But it was just, there's something about what, it'll just make you reflect in on yourself. So it looks like I'm buying it for the talent involved and the premise. I thought the trailer was great. So yeah, give it to me.
I'm going to tentatively buy it. I liked the trailer, but I felt that, like you, John, there were certain elements of the trailer that felt a little too, I don't know, let's say histrionic, expositional, where it's like that news back and forth. Well, please tell us about the discovery. They had to say the discovery like three times in the trailer. And I love the idea of it. It's just like we found out there's seven worlds that we can live on that are 40 million light years away that have water and all that kind of stuff. When you find out stuff like that, it's very intriguing, but there's really nothing we can do about it. If we found out tomorrow that, yes, there is proof that there is life after death. What is it, though? That's the kind of thing that if 4 million people rush off and kill themselves to go to, what is it? Are they going to purgatory? What is the life after death? You're just a thing floating in a bubble. You know,
going to watch Maleficent 2?
Yeah, or yeah, you're stuck watching Maleficent 2 forever. I mean, it's like sort of like, please let me live forever. Yeah, it's like, I don't know, but I like the idea of it, but so I'm going to buy right now the trailer. We're going to see it soon.
All right, guys. Well, I want to remind you that we're doing this show live, and as we like to do at the end of the show, we're going to save a few minutes to take some of your live Twitter questions if you are watching us live. And if you are, just make sure you're following us on Twitter at Collider Video and start firing us some questions. Wendy will pick a couple out to read at the end of the show. But I also want to remind you that Movie Talk is not the only show on Collider Video. A little bit later today, this man, Kristian Harloff, and his Jedi Council. The newest episode will be up a little bit later today. Check for that. Also, yesterday, a brand new episode of Nightmares went online. Go and check that out. And, of course, an all-new Schmodown tomorrow with Mark Bernardin and Nick
Scarpino.
Scarpino. I always want to say Shapiro.
Yeah.
Scarpino. That goes up tomorrow. Keep browsing from that. And, of course, brand new episode of Awesome Tacular hits Verizon Go 90 tomorrow. Now, with all that out of the way, let's get to the mailbag. Listen, if you've got a topic or a question you'd like us to address on the show, email us anytime at collidervideo@gmail.com. Sometimes we use your questions here on Movie Talk. Sometimes we use them for our weekend mailbag show. So maybe you'll see it pop up there. But for now, Natasha, what is in the mailbag?
Sam writes, hey, Collider crew. I've been watching for a year now since stumbling on Jedi Council, and I've had the best year of movie watching I can remember. My question is about Campea's term continuity schmontinuity as used when describing the X-Men movies to which you all seem to agree. Is this excusing Fox from being faithful to their own franchise when we would be booing the screen if it was a Star Wars canon? I look forward to another great year of movie discussion on Collider.
I think it's all because, look, if Star Wars started doing it now, it would be horrendous because it's not what they have been doing for 40 years. With X-Men, they pretty much going right into X-Men 2 said, look, their focus was not building a universe per se. Fox's focus has not been on building a cinematic universe, and that's fine. They have just been focused on them trying, sometimes succeeding, sometimes failing, but trying to make the best individual movies they can. And if that means we have to pretend like the Sabretooth in X-Men 1 didn't exist and now Liev Schreiber is Sabretooth, then we do that. If we had to pretend that actually, you know, Angel would have been born in this year, well, now we're saying Angel would have been born in this year. That's fine with them too, because they're not concerned about overall universe building. They're concerned just about making the best individual movies they can. That's why the director of Logan came out a while ago and said, well, you know, it's not exactly within the timeline of everything. Well, no X-Men movie has been exactly within the timeline. Even when they tried to do their reset with X-Men Days of Future Past. I mean, that could have been a get out of jail free card for them if they wanted to then build a cinematic universe. But they didn't. It wasn't what was important to them. And that's totally fine. So, but when you're talking about Star Wars, again, Star Wars has built a universe that they say does need to be consistent with itself. So it would be two different sets of rules. So I don't believe it's double standards at all. It's just one was intending to do one thing, one was intending to do the other, and both of them are sticking with what they always intended to do. How do you explain this?
Yeah, I agree. I think that X-Men has really made a thing out of this particular, it might fit into the stuff that we set up in the last movie. This one might not. Marvel certainly doesn't do that. Marvel right now, Marvel Comics and the Marvel movies completely different, but the Marvel Cinematic Universe right now has been in continuity because that's what they're setting up. They're setting up from A to B. And the same thing with Star Wars. And Star Wars is everything. Star Wars has to be in sync with comics and games and books, so they can't switch stuff up because people would lose their minds. You're like, wait, what did I just, you told me that I needed to know this in order to know that. X-Men's not telling you that. X-Men's saying that for this movie, Apocalypse, you should be connected to the last two that we've done in this particular timeline, but Logan's not. They're letting you know this beforehand. That's the difference between, say, X-Men and then Marvel and then Star Wars.
Schnepp.
Yeah, I mean, well, when you have a movie like Logan, which has got, like, I think the highest rated superhero film that I've ever seen as far as my rating system goes, it doesn't matter about continuity. I mean, that they cover some bases and it's murky in others is completely fine by me. And X-Men, just if you just watch X-Men Wolverine Origins, that's the one, the most egregious of all of the, you know, what pocket universe does this one fit into? The one that's been flushed, you know, because they got rid of it with Days of Future Past. So they're constantly changing and evolving their, like, space-time continuum, parallel universes of I don't know how many different versions of X-Men live right now if you wanted to break up all of the movies. They're all different, but does it really matter? Some I love, some I hate. You know, it's win, lose. You know, I think it's just like James Bond. You get a brand new Bond every couple of years. Mm. You might love him, you might hate him, but you know in a couple of years you're going to get a different Bond.
Jeremy?
Actually, that's a good point. Like, James Bond's not in any form of continuity, you know, so there is that. Fox and X-Men isn't the first thing. I got to preface this. I do toss around in my head, if they were ever to retell the fall of Anakin Skywalker, just redo it, I don't think I would cry. That being said, I deal with what I have. But it really is it's like Tyrion Lannister said, like, wear it like armor and it can never be used against you. From the get-go, Fox is like, look, man, we're not doing continuity. It doesn't matter. They just own it. It's kind of like Howard Stern can say the things Howard Stern says because Howard Stern has always been Howard Stern. If Jay Leno started saying the things that Howard Stern said, the world would melt down and lose their mind. So it really does. Like, you just got to preface it from the beginning, own it, let it go out there, and just be you. And they know what they are, they know what they're doing, and they just own it. So, I mean, right there, they're just playing it smart. If they tried to hide it somehow, I'm like, well, we're going to try, then it would start to fall apart. But if you just own the facts, they're rocking it.
All right, what's next?
Raziel writes, hello, Movie Talk crew. I saw the movie Fences, and it was great all around, but I saw that Viola Davis was nominated for Best Supporting Actress. The movie is about Denzel's character, but Viola's character was there with him most of the time, and she was the leading actress. To me, Viola Davis should have been nominated and win it for Best Actress and not for Best Supporting Actress. I want to hear your thoughts on whether Viola Davis was nominated in the wrong category, and if this is a similar situation as when Christian Bale was nominated and won for Best Supporting Actor in The Fighter. Thanks for taking my question.
Absolutely. I remember I was reading this question earlier, and it's like, well, this is the Christian Bale situation again, and then they mentioned it at the bottom of the thing. This is exactly the Christian Bale situation again. Look, there is one major flaw in the Academy system, and I believe the Academy has the best system out of any of the award shows. It's the best one, but it still has its problems. And one of the biggest problems that they have is this, is that the studios get to decide whether or not they want an actor or an actress to be considered for a supporting actor or supporting actress. That shouldn't be up to them, because Christian Bale in The Fighter was a lead role. It was the lead actor. He had pretty much just as much screen time as Mark Wahlberg, probably more lines than Mark Wahlberg. It's him and Wahlberg on the poster. The movie was about the two of them. But they knew that Christian Bale had no shot that year of beating Colin Firth, who was in The King's Speech. They knew Colin Firth was going to win that. He had no shot. So they just said, oh, we'll put him in supporting actor, when it was not a supporting performance. It was not a smaller role. He should not have been there. And as a result, Andrew Garfield, who should have been nominated for The Social Network, probably should have won that damn award that year. He didn't even get nominated because it got taken up by an actor who really played a lead performance. And that's unfortunate, but it is the rules. So I guarantee you, this was the studio who probably looked at it and said, you know what? Viola's probably got a better chance of getting a nomination, number one, and maybe a better chance at winning if we just put her into the supporting. And the thing I hate about that is it lessens the supporting actor category. Yep. It diminishes when you say, oh, well, let's look at best supporting as a movie prize. No, supporting performances can make or break movies. And the actors who play in those roles, whether they're big actors or not, shouldn't feel like they're in a diminished thing. I just hate that. I agree with you. She should have been in the best lead actress category. Whether or not she would have been nominated, who knows? But that shouldn't be the studio's decision. It should be the Academy's decision to say, this role does qualify supporting, this role does not. I don't like the way it's set up right now. What do you think, Christian?
I'm going to go the other side. I especially want to start with The Fighter. I don't think it was Christian Bale's movie. I think that he was the standout, and he was absolutely the best performance for sure. The story was about Mickey Ward. Yeah, Dickie Ward had a big part to do with it, but it was the story about how Mickey Ward came back, was this fighter, won the title. Christian Bale was a standout. Christian Bale won for best supporting actor. I feel the same way with Viola Davis. I think Viola Davis is the standout. She is the clear lead actress in the movie, that's where the argument can come. But as far as the story itself goes, she was a supporting actor or actress to Denzel's lead character. That's the way that I see it. I understand your point of view for sure, but I just see it as far as the story goes. I can understand when they're looking at it and saying she is the supporting to what Denzel is doing here. Denzel is front and center. Denzel is the lead. She is the one that is giving him all of the juice, the back and forth. She's leading and adding to his performance. But I see him as the lead. I see Mickey Ward, a.k.a. Mark Wahlberg, as the lead. So I understand why they were nominated.
Jeremy.
Yeah, I didn't. When watching the movie all of, I think it was like 7 years ago now, or 6 years ago, The Fighter, I remember thinking of Christian Bale as a supporting role. But breaking it down, if you look at script, screen time, and poster, he does have just as much as Mark Wahlberg. But I suppose there is that perception of people are going to argue over the perception of what is a lead and what is supporting and where's the line, because there's no real hard line. There's no
definition.
Yeah, can't say, oh, it fills in there, and so it's clearly on that side of the line. It really is a fuzzy line where people just got to allocate where they think it is. I do agree with you. The Academy, if it's their award show, should be able to go, no, that's a lead, that's mm-hmm. a supporting, and that's our show. Better luck next year. But in terms of whether or not Viola Davis should be the lead, if she is supporting, I hope it's because she was supporting in the movie, not because of some like political switcheroo, so she might have a better chance here or there. But I gotta say, I love the person who asked the question. I love his name because it's Raziel, and that's from Legacy of Kain. Good job, man.
Schnepp.
I gotta call bullshit because, you know, Michael Shannon is up for best supporting actor.
Yes.
And he's
yes.
in the movie for literally possibly 5 minutes. You add up all of his screen time, and he's great, and he's an amazing actor, and he did a great job as a supporting actor. Viola Davis is the lead actor in Fences. She has more screen time than Denzel Washington, who's the co-lead. They're both leads. She's not a supporting actress, however you want to phrase it. She is the lead actor in the movie. The reason she's up for supporting is exactly what you said, game playing. They're like, there's no way she's going to win against all these other people, so let's put her in the supporting actress role, and it's cheating out all the other actresses who were supporting actors in those films that were in 5 or 10 minutes, but weren't the lead actresses in the lead actress role. I think it's a dirty deed, but does she deserve an Oscar? Hell yes. So if the studio,
she's amazing in it.
She's mm-hmm. incredible. She totally deserves, if she was lead actress nominated, I would say she wins even over Emma Stone. I think Emma Stone should win the lead actress role, but if Viola Davis, I think she should win supporting actress because she was the lead actress, period, in this film and the best actress of last year. So I feel it's kind of like it's playing sides, and I don't like the way they're doing that, so I think it's cheating. But I guess if the actress that really should win at least wins an Oscar, then they're doing something right.
All right, guys, so I said we'd save some time to get to your live Twitter questions, and we're going to do that right now. Once again, make sure you follow us on Twitter, @ ColliderVideo. Wendy, what have you picked out?
The first one comes from a Twitter user whose name I cannot pronounce, so I am not going to try, but they write, do you think Chris Pratt's role in Infinity War will be small because he filmed only 2 weeks and now he is busy with Jurassic World?
I don't know that that's a fact. If it is a fact, then yeah, obviously. Yeah. If they're shooting one movie for 6 months and then another movie for another 6 months, and one of the actors shoots for 2 weeks, then yes, it is probably a good bet that the role is probably small. But then again, I cannot confirm that that is true, that he only shot for 2 weeks. Also, even if it's true, if he may have shot for 2 weeks and then goes off to shoot Jurassic World, nothing is he might go off to shoot Jurassic World for 4 months and then come back and shoot more for the next two Avenger films. We don't know yet, but I do suspect Pratt's role will not be on the same level as Chris Evans' role, as Robert Downey Jr.'s role. I still believe that the Avengers are going to be front. This is an Avengers movie. So I do believe Captain America, Iron Man, these guys are going to be front. Scarlett Johansson, I believe these characters are going to be front and center with some supporting roles from all the other characters. Yeah. Shep, what do you think?
Do you like Ant-Man when he was in Civil War? I think that's the amount of screen time that Star-Lord is going to have in Infinity War, and that's just enough. I think 2 weeks, remember, that's 14 days, and they take the weekends off. That's 10 full days of shooting. You saw them on that crazy set in that behind-the-scenes footage where it's like Iron Man, Spider-Man, and Star-Lord hanging out. Whether they're all in the same scene or not in that scene, we don't know. But they're all on the same set together. They're going to be doing multiple scenes together. You could shoot so much footage in 2 weeks. You know? He could have shot 30 minutes of footage. We don't know that. Like, all the other 6 months of shooting these incredible, elaborate special effects scenes. So there's no way to tell or judge how much he'll be in the film. But just by gauging how many other characters are in that movie, which is everyone in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, they're kind of like going to piecemeal it out a little bit. Everyone's going to have sections. There's going to be at least one big scene where everybody's on screen together, sort of similar to the airport scene in Avengers right. Civil War, where we've got everyone on screen together, but otherwise it'll be, you know, placements and pockets. So, you know, Ant-Man was just enough in Civil War. I think we'll have way more than enough of Star-Lord, even for 2 weeks.
Jeremy?
Yeah, I hope with Ant-Man, I hope Star-Lord has a standout, because if you think of that airport scene, Ant-Man had a couple moments where you're like, that was one of the coolest scenes, and there it grows really huge, you know? Like, you think of Ant-Man front and center, other than Spider-Man or a couple others, you know, everyone has their time to shine, but Ant-Man definitely had a standout time to shine. I hope if Star-Lord is only in Infinity War briefly, I hope he does have an important thing to do or a standout moment where we're like, oh, okay, he had to be in here, not just fan service that he is in here, which it essentially is.
Christian?
I think it'll be significant. No, how long it'll be, basically saying what you're saying here, Jeremy, is with the Ant-Man scene, how that was, you remember it, but it was short and sweet. I think it'll be the same thing. And I think that's it's just going to set us up for more time once everybody's in it a lot more once part two comes out. But I think that he will have a big part. I don't want him to have that much. I want him to focus more on the characters, the core group, and then it'll mean that much more when some of the Guardians come in, especially Star-Lord. So I think it'll be a fair amount of time for the amount of time we need. It won't be a little cameo. It'll be a nice scene. It'll probably be a nice action scene with some humor, obviously, that you don't have Pratt in there without throwing in some quips between him and Tony Stark. So I think that it'll be a nice, I'd say between 10 to 15 minutes, and I'll be happy with that.
All right, what's next?
Oops, sorry, lost my place. All right, this one comes from Robert Dijon, who writes, what will Collider do during the Oscars?
Oh, yeah. Okay, that's great. So Oscars is this Sunday. It's the biggest day of the movie calendar. We are going to be getting together here. We are going to be doing a live pre-show. Help me out. 3 to 4 o'clock. Wendy?
Sorry. Hi. Sorry. Sorry.
We are doing a live pre-show from 3 to 4.
Yeah, 3 to 4.
So from 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, that's 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, to 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, we're going to be doing a live pre-show. You're going to be able to watch that. Then during the Oscars, we're going to have a live stream going where during each commercial break, a bunch of us are going to be running on the camera, talk about what we just saw. And then after the Oscars are done, we're going to be doing a live post-Oscars wrap-up show. So we're going to be doing a lot that day. I know about 2 months ago, somebody asked if we might do a fan event for the Oscars, and we were looking at it. We were kind of hoping to set this thing up where we could get this one venue and have like maybe a couple hundred fans come and join us for it. Unfortunately, we weren't able to make that work. We tried. But make sure you join us on our YouTube channel. Follow us, and make sure you're following our Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter that day. Keep our YouTube channel open and watch the Oscars along with us. That's what we're going to be doing. All right, what's next?
The next one comes from Chris Gomez, who writes, what are your thoughts on releasing toys and action figures prior to movie releasing? Does it create movie spoilers?
It can.
It can. Yeah.
It does.
Yeah, I've seen it happen. Yeah.
It has. I mean, generally speaking, no, it's totally fine. I mean, you want to put out a Rey action figure of Star Wars or something like that? That's fine. You want to put out a picture of Rey holding Kylo Ren's severed head? That might be a little too much.
Or in reality, her holding a lightsaber.
A lightsaber, yeah.
Or
that was actually happening. Yeah, yeah. They really did that.
I mean, she holds a lightsaber, and I mean,
no. This is way before anyone even knew that she was possibly going to be a Jedi or had Force powers or anything. They had a shot of her
in the commercial. They did it
with
a little
girl.
Yeah,
a girl doing Force pushes and stuff like that. It's like they gotta walk a fine line. Like 95% of the time, the toys don't give away any spoilers, but it's that 5% of the time that we remember. So they do need to be careful about this stuff. Any other thoughts, guys?
Yeah, Hot Toys was really careful about that when they came out with their 6-scale Rey. It was just, oh, Rey as we saw her in the trailer. And then sometime after the movie came out, they're like, oh, by the way, here's a lightsaber she comes with too. And it was, so they kept it super secret. Mm-hmm. So props for that. But yeah, on another Star Wars note, I remember when Phantom Menace was coming out and it straight up the toys were like, yeah, Padme and her decoy are, you know, they're different people. Like Amidala and Padme. Yeah. Padme's the queen, and you're not supposed to know that Padme is the queen. Well, here she is. It's Natalie Portman. She's the queen. Well, you're like, oh, okay.
I was going to say, all you sweaties who are like at Toy Fair, guess what? Now you know what the shocker looks like. Now you know. So the toys, they show in advance, and there's some stills of the Vulture or Spider-Man, but like then they have a toy of the shocker, or Lego is always constantly doing like, hey, look, there's Giant Man from Civil War. You're like, what? So people are freaking out and crying in a fetal position because they found out Ant-Man turns into Giant Man. That's not that big of a deal, but I understand it if you're like, you want to get everything sacred and don't even watch the trailers or anything. It's up to you if you want to be that, you know, seriously weird about it. I think it's like, hey, Giant Man's in it. I can't believe you ruined the movie.
That's how I am.
And let's not forget, this isn't just limited to Legos or toys or things. Like one of the greatest examples of this, of marketing and merchandising and things like that that go out before a movie comes out, we talk about it all the time. Star Wars, Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. Before the movie even comes out, they put out the score. Remember this?
Yeah.
They put out the soundtrack. And one of the titles,
right.
One of the titles on the soundtrack, and one of the pieces of music is Qui-Gon's Noble End.
Yeah.
It's like, what the fuck?
Yeah. What does that mean? Does that mean he dies? Yeah. I think so.
The very next track is Qui-Gon's funeral.
Yeah. Yeah. Right, something's burning. Yeah, I think I figured that out,
Smells like chicken.
Yeah. I mean, so it happens. They do got to be careful. All right, that'll do it for us, guys, for this installment of Movie Talk. Thanks so much for joining us. I want to thank the guys sitting at the table with me. First of all, Mr. Jon Schnepp, where can people find you online?
You can find me in cryo sleep waiting for a habitable planet 40 million years away from the sun. See you later.
And they can follow you on Twitter, too.
You can find me on Twitter and, Instagram. Jon Schnepp, bye.
Mr. Jeremy Jahns.
Schnepp's just waiting for that world to be habitable. You can find me at Jeremy Jahns on YouTube, Twitter, rest of the internet. You can find my show Awesome Tacular on the Verizon Go 90 network. We have a lot of fun there, so come check it out. Be nerdy with us.
Mr. Kristian Harloff.
Well, you can find me today, like John mentioned, on Collider Jedi Council every Saturday on Rebels, our Rebels recap. We Kristian Harloff on Twitter and Instagram. And we have, John mentioned, we have Nick Scarpino and Mark Bernardin from Fat Man on Batman going head-to-head on the Movie Trivia Schmodown. Make sure you check that out. Thanks.
And over there we got Natasha Martinez.
You guys can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at NatashaLexis_.
And Wendy Lee and her cat.
You can find me on YouTube at The Movie Couple Channel and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat at Wendy Lee Zaney.
And you can simply follow me on Facebook and on Twitter just at John Campea. That'll do for us, guys. Thanks so much for joining us. And until next time, bye-bye.
Hey, guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.